Hi folks, welcome to the webinar today. Glad you can make it. My name is Barry Kazier. I'm the national speaker here at Postcard Mania and your presenter today. So I want to go over a few housekeeping items really quick before we begin. If you cannot hear me or see me or see the screen, just let me know with a quick little chat here. If you can see me, great. Looks like everybody so far can. That's awesome. You'll also notice on the control panel here at the right, you can ask questions. You can click on that question button and you can type in questions there for me. And then I'll make sure and get those questions answered. Don't be shy, you can ask questions at any time, and then I'll make sure to answer the questions. There'll be a little Q&A period at the end of the webinar, so we'll definitely show that to you, or go over that with you. And then if your questions don't get answered here while you're with us, then I'll make sure to answer those afterwards, but I should have plenty of time to be able to answer them while you're with us. So can everybody hear me okay? And there's what our webinar is. If you can see that screen, just indicate it. Is your website losing you clients? So that's what we're going to be covering today. And we're going to be going over today, it's 2016, your website is your firm. People identify it as who you are. That perception, that website is the reality in this digital age. So how can you ensure that your website not only looks good, but represents you, and first and foremost is an effective marketing tool for booking more appointments and getting you new clients? So it's easy, we're going to show you. So again, I want to thank you for joining me today. Once we're done, you'll be able to identify the elements of a website that's optimized for lead capturing. You'll be able to make correct changes to your website or direct those changes to capture more leads. And you're going to learn how to grow your tax business with minimal marketing investment. So I'm Barry Kazier, by the way. I'm the national speaker, like I mentioned, for Postcard Mania. I'm a marketing educator and consultant specializing in small businesses. So I've trained and consulted over 10,000 small business owners and delivered hundreds and hundreds of seminars and workshops to small businesses across the U.S. I really love educating small business owners on marketing tools and strategies, and most of all, helping them to grow their business. That's what we're all about here. This is our CEO and her family, Joy Gendusa. She's the CEO of CEO of Postcard Mania. She's pretty amazing. I'm going to tell you a little bit about Joy, and I'm going to show you Postcard Mania in just a second at its beginning. So this is Postcard Mania at its beginnings in 1998. Joy started this with only a phone, a computer, and postcard marketing. That means she had no capital injection or venture capital backing. Nobody was backing her financially. She made the money and grew the business that way. Today, she's taken this small startup back in 1998 and turned it into an industry leader. Postcard Mania currently employs 200 people in the Tampa Bay area. We generate over $45 million in annual revenue, and we've helped more than 73,000 small business owners with their marketing. So Joy is more than just a business owner, though. She's an entrepreneur, author, established speaker, and philanthropist. She's been awarded the Tampa Bay CEO of the Year, Entrepreneur, Businesswoman of the Year in Tampa Bay twice, and has been given the Ernst & Young Entrepreneur of the Year finalist. So that's pretty amazing. So how did she do this and grow this business from this startup to what it is now? So if you were to ask Joy, she would tell you she grew the company with marketing, and we have as our mission to help you do the same. So I'm going to give you a short bit of what she did to grow Postcard Mania. When Joy started out, she was mailing 1,000 postcards per week every week. She'd been preaching to her clients the importance of mailings, and now she was practicing what she was preaching. And the result, her revenue increased. So she upped it to 2,500 pieces each week. She ran with that for several months and noticed that after the initial increase in revenue, we plateaued at a new higher range in sales. Now at the time, it was pretty painful to raise the quantity of our outgoing mail. Postage was the lion's share of our marketing cost, and it was a big expense to test sending out 5,000 postcards instead of 2,500 and observe the results. But based on the revenue increase from 1,000 pieces to 2,500, she knew it seemed logical, even if scary, and she was not paying herself a lot at that time. So she bit the bullet and went for it. She increased the postcards out the door to 5,000 pieces per week for a commitment of 6 weeks. And within 4 weeks, Postcard Mania doubled its orders and revenue. The test was over 15 years ago. Today we mail 180,000 postcards to promote Postcard Mania every single week without fail. In fact, Postcard Mania has not missed a single week of mailing out postcards in over 18 years. So Postcard Mania now offers way more than postcards: website design, Google pay-per-click management, email marketing, and we continue to innovate products to make you more money. In fact, Postcard Mania is the only postcard marketing company that creates your custom marketing campaign based on proven results. Proven as if, as in, they've worked actually for over 73,000 businesses. So let's get into this webinar and tell you about your website and how we can make it work for you. First, I want to cover your job as a marketer, right? So now that consists of these four basic things in essence. The first thing you have to do is capture a lead. Is generate some leads, actually. You have to generate leads one way or another with a lot of different ways of marketing. Postcards is how we did it. It really works in your industry and many industries, and so generating leads is where we start. Then you have to capture the lead. You have to collect those identities, because without that phone number and the basic information, then you don't have anyone to follow up with. And follow up is the next thing. So you've got that, can't be overstated. We're going to talk about that more a little bit later. And then finally, you have to close the deal. So this, in essence, is what you do as a marketer, and is the simplicity of your job as a marketer. Now we're going to focus on lead capture today, and we're going to talk about your website, what really has to do with lead capturing. Because after you've generated that lead, using all the different ways that you can generate leads and create interest, where somebody is interested, has some level of interest in what you're doing and what you're offering, the first thing people do is they go to your website. In fact, we know by statistic 95% of interested prospects will visit your website before contacting you. So you've got this large group of people that you've created that go to your website, and a percentage of those become leads and a percentage of them don't. And what we want to do is we want to increase that percentage of people who actually become leads and become your customers. The first thing you need to do with your website before we get rolling here is you need to see whether or not it's working and doing its job or not. So you need to talk to your web guy and really get him to put in this program called Google Analytics. Now, Google Analytics is a free program. It's easy to use. It's not complex. You go around, click the buttons. You can figure it out. If you can figure out Facebook, you can figure out Google Analytics. Just don't be scared of it. You can find out which online campaigns bring the most traffic and the most conversions. Now, you can learn what people are searching for in your site. You can see what people click on the most. And you can see you can see exactly what they click on the most. Here we go. So you can see exactly what they click on the most, and you can uncover your top content, and you can identify the worst performing pages. So all those things you can do with your website. So with Google Analytics here. Now, a bad website will instantly decrease interest and trust in you instantly. And a good website will increase that trust and interest instantly. And the first thing is the website mood itself. So I want to show you a couple websites here and show you the difference in mood between these websites, and I'll actually show you what a good website looks like and how it develops actually the mood of what we're dealing with. So first off, we've got this website for handmade maps. It's natural, friendly, and a little bit old school. Next, we've got a spa. A spa is obviously relaxing. That's the main message here. I mean, you definitely get that communication, is that it's a relaxing environment. This is a dental website and it deals with kids. Now, a parent that's going to this website, they want to know that the kids are going to have fun and that it's a kid-friendly environment. So that's what they want to know. This website, this is a lawyer's website. The feeling a lawyer is supposed to give is trust, credibility, professionalism. You want to know these things about your lawyer, that there's trust there, that there's credibility and such. And so the look and the feel of the website actually has to communicate that. And then with the CPA, you're looking to have professional, organized, it actually, that's exactly what this website communicates. It's very professional, very organized. It's somewhat business-like, right? But it's also looks good. So that's the mood of the website, and that's where you want to start off with, so people instantly get a feeling and flavor for who you are. Now we're going to cover 9 things that every great website must include. Right out of the box, we've got to have color that pops. Your website needs to have color that actually pops out and, gets the person, pulls the person in, that's attractive, that's interesting, and gets their attention. So this has got some great greens in it and some blues that really pop out of the page, and they pull me in, and I'm interested in this website. It's got other great elements that we'll cover too. Now here's a bad example. This example of the website is, it's sort of dull, uninteresting. I think you'd probably agree the colors don't pop off the page at all. And so this is a bad example of colors that pop. So you want a graphic designer that can actually give you a website that will give you color that actually pops. Next is lead capture forms. So with a lead capture form, you want to make sure it's at the same place on every single page. You don't want it to be at a different place on different pages. People should be able to have that as a, it's right there again. I should fill it out. And if you've got it on a long scrolling website, you want it to show up periodically when the person is scrolling through the site itself. So make that prominent right there for people. As a matter of fact, just because a website looks great doesn't mean that it's optimized for marketing and converting leads. So, like for instance, on this one, it actually shows, there's no contact form per se at all. Okay? So that's lead capture forms. Next is consistent contact information. Right there at the top corner, same place every time, that's a great place for it. That's right, your eyes end up going there. This is because we read left to right. That's how we read. And then we've right there at the top there, we've got the contact information, the various ways to contact me through Google, instruction to call me today, a way for you to email me, the whole deal. It's all right there for you. Now here with this website, you actually have to search to figure out how to contact them. We're going to have to take extra steps. We're going to have to click on that contact form over there to actually get to where we can send you an email or call you. So that's no good. The next point is useful photos. You want to make sure that the website that you have has useful photos on it, preferably not stock photos, the photos of you, photos of your clients, those type of things exactly. So this is a great example of a photo that's useful. It's got a couple or possibly a tax guy helping a person with their taxes. So it obviously shows that interaction where they're getting busy doing the work here of tax handling. This picture does not communicate tax professional, really. It's like a high-rise building, big windows. I don't know if we're leasing space here or what exactly we're doing, but it's not a useful photo. It doesn't communicate at all. It doesn't tell me that this is a CPA firm. I don't know what it is. I'm window washing. I'm just not sure. So useful photos is a huge deal. The website has to have something about you. This is a great picture, very personal picture. You've got a great description of the CPA, goes into who he is, what he's about, and so it's something about you. And if you check out the Postcard Mania website, you'll see throughout the website that there are lots of examples of exactly that, different things about Postcard Mania, the people, right there on the homepage, as a matter of fact. And throughout, you'll find tons of examples of that. This is a bad example. You've got here, you've got stock photos, not your real clients, not your real staff. So you've got this stock photo that's stretched out and a not really good description of the business itself. Not good, doesn't work. The next point is ratings and reviews. Ratings and reviews are huge. You know, you want to get them on there. You got a variety of reviews, 5-star, 4-stars. You know, occasionally you got a situation that you handled well and it shows up there as part of your reviews. But you want to have them on your website and show that you're real. 90% of consumers say that the online reviews impact their buying decision. Now, all of us know if we travel to Amazon, we know that that's true. We go to Amazon and we look at the reviews and we make a decision based on what we see. I know I go to Yelp quite a bit for restaurants and such, and I visit Yelp and I'll find out that, you know, a restaurant has X number of reviews, it's got a bunch of 4- or 5-star reviews. Okay, this looks like a place that I'm interested in going to see. Believe it or not, 79% of consumers trust online reviews as much as personal recommendations. So that's a huge percentage of people that actually trust online reviews as much as personal recommendations. The next point is videos. Videos, 80% of the world's internet traffic will be video per Cisco's, they did a study, and by 2019, 80% of the world's internet traffic will be video. That's a lot of video and a lot of traffic. So one of the things you want to have is, you know, this is a great example, by the way. If you add a video to a page with a lead capture form, you can increase your actual conversion rates. You can double them. You can increase them up to 201%. So this, you know, integrating video, having testimonials and such, this is a fantastic thing, totally what you need to do. The next is a blog. You definitely want to have a blog on your website for a number of really good reasons. This is actually an award-winning blog, and you can see that the CPA here is writing some great articles about his practice and what he's doing to help people. Now, what is a blog? A blog is a website which an individual or a group of users where they record their opinions, articles, video, photos, information, etc. on a regular basis. It's either a website or a part of a website. The verb is to blog, which means to add new material to regularly update a blog. It comes from the words web log, blog. The benefits are it keeps people coming back to your website again and again. It builds trust and affinity between your business and prospects, and establishes you as a more humanized business that truly loves what you do. You're writing about it, you're telling people, you know, you're communicating in a great way about what you do, and that comes across. Now, just a tip on blogging, interestingly enough, headlines with negative superlatives get 60% more click-throughs than those with positive superlatives. Now, so that's words like worst, never, those are the negative side of things, or always, or best, or the positives. So worst and never beat out best and always. Headlines with negative superlatives also beat out headlines with no superlatives at all. You can see this example here. We got 7.6% best practices for generating referral leads, 12% when to absolutely not use postcards seriously. Get up to 12.6%. So here's a bad example of a blog. You do not want to have a blog that isn't a blog. There's nothing there. You know, he went through the time and effort to create the blog, but there's no information. He's never added to it. So so that's not good. You want to basically make sure that you're actually, you know, adding information on a regular basis to your blog. The next point is responsive design. So we're in the age of mobile, and your website actually has to adapt itself for the mobile phone, for tablets, etc. You can see the difference between these two websites. The larger one's obviously a desk version I'm looking at on my desk computer. The smaller one is my cell phone. And then, you know, I also might have something where I look at it on my monitor. So the website actually adjusts, is responsive or responds to the screen that you're looking at it through. Here's an example of one that's not a responsive design. The text is hard to read, it's too small, I have to blow up the text to look at it, and you know, basically it's just a, you know, not a good example. So as far as the importance of mobile, consumers get 60% of their traffic, their time is spent on a mobile device versus the desktop. As a matter of fact, more Google searches take place on a mobile device than on computers in 10 countries, including the US and Japan. So, yeah, so this is a big deal. Mobile search has actually taken over desktop searching completely. So it's a huge deal, and you definitely have to pay attention to it. Google made it official with regards to how important mobile was in April 2015. They updated their algorithm, which is their like big mathematical formula that figures out where to put things on the search engine, and they give preference in search results to mobile-friendly web pages on mobile devices. So you can see on some search engines whether or not your website's mobile friendly, and otherwise Google actually has a special website you can go to where you can find out whether or not your site's mobile friendly or not. So here's that checklist again. So there are 9 elements that every great website must include. Colors that pop, they definitely have to jump out of the screen at you. Lead capture forms, same place every time, prominent, top of the page, or throughout the page. If you've got a scrolling page, it's just got to be there. Consistent contact information at the top corner, like we showed you. Useful photos, preferably not stock photos, but actual photos of you and your people that you work with. Something about you. Again, this can include photos, write-ups, etc., interesting videos, reviews of your business and who you are and what you're doing. Videos definitely would be integrated. Testimonial videos, like we talked, can greatly increase the conversion rate. A blog, and so that you're constantly building your site. And finally, responsive design. So now, if you're using a website company to develop a website for you, there's 6 jobs that this website company really needs to do for you. They definitely need to wear these 6 hats. We're going to go over them with you. First, they have to have a knowledge of aesthetic aspect of design. So they have to be able to know what the appropriate colors are. They have to be able to use photos, ideally non-stock photos. They have to be willing to do that and able to do that. They definitely have to be able to integrate your logo and see how to use a logo and when to use it and use yours consistently and in a way that makes sense with the rest of the scheme of the website. The marketing aspects is vital. Your web developer has to understand that you're there to capture leads. So they've got to be turning visitors into leads for you. You should be receiving those leads on a regular basis. They've got to have a knowledge of that. They have to be able to beef up that copy with search term rich copy. And then speaking of that, search engine optimization is the third hat that they need to be able to wear. They have to optimize page titles to make sure that those have the keywords integrated or they're laid out properly. The site is organized properly. They have to ensure the text is readable by the search engines. All of those factors have to be included in the website development. Copywriting aspect, the website has to be optimized for search engine optimization, should be proofread, should be no errors. The text should be conversational and stay away from using lingo and words that are so specialized to your field that nobody understands it. And then the copy itself needs to be rich with keywords. When it gets to the programming aspect of your website, the code itself needs to be very tidy. It needs to have a quick load time, so the website needs to load quickly. You need to be able to test it across all different browsers. It needs to be work on Explorer as well as Chrome as well as whatever other browser that you might use. So the programmer has to be able to do his job and know what he's doing. So you can see there's a lot of aspects to developing a website, not just the marketing, not just the programming aspect. And finally, they have to be able to track what's going on. Again, we're back to you talking about Google Analytics, which is a free program that they can plug into your website. They can tell you what pages are visited the most, which pages cause visitors to leave the site, and what pages visitors are spending the most time on. All of these are vital aspects for your web developer to be able to look at, understand, and help you to build an even better website. Here's a couple good examples. Great contact information, video on the homepage, nice testimonial it looks like, or possibly the CPA himself, and a lead capture form right there. We're just asking for the email address to sign up for the newsletter for starters. Contact information on the homepage again, images related to their services, and the form on the homepage is there to collect visitors and contact information. Now you've got another good example, contact information logo right there, email sign up right there on the homepage. Here's a great book that gets into exactly the specifics of it. It's such an easy read. It's amazing. It's actually a lot of fun to read. Steve Krug, Don't Make Me Think. A fun book, really interesting, definitely will empower you regarding websites and whether your website is usable and getting the results that you need as far as the experience people get and how they're able to find things and such when they come to your website and a lot more. And then, of course, the return on investment regarding your website. This here's a great book, more technical, so you can dig into that, or you can give it to your web guy and have them do it. But remember, the person who's wearing this hat, you might ask them if they've read these books. So back to your job as a marketer once more. We're going to talk a little bit more, even more specifically regarding lead capture. So you've got a great website here. And you've got the website that's going to track people. It's got all the elements that it needs to have. It's been put together by a good person. Now, how do we make sure those leads are captured? One of the things is social proof. Social proof is those signs or evidence that you're accepted. For instance, here we've got various magazines that have published articles or information or given, you know, some sort of credibility to the people who created this website and its principles. That can improve conversion dramatically, 144% improvement. Putting a trust seal on a website, this is important with regards to e-commerce and can increase your conversion rate by up to 9%. So you'll get an extra sign up, you know, like 1 out of 10 people will actually sign up who wouldn't have. The less information you ask for, the better. If you ask for 6 fields, you're going to get a 15% conversion rate. If you do 4 or 5 fields, you're looking at a 20% conversion rate. But if you bring it down to 3 fields, you've now increased it to a 25% conversion rate. You don't want to put any of those little asterisks on there that require somebody to fill out anything, some aspect of the form. And remember that if you ask for a phone number, it creates an average dip in conversions of 5%. So good, a little bit more on lead capturing. You want to make sure your call to action button actually stands out. So this looks just like the postcard that was sent out. It's right there, boom. There's your offer, and there you go. It pulls people in. It looks different from the rest of the page there. It's a nice purple that totally stands out. There's our example. We've got a great get started, boom. Enter your email address, let's start now. Here's an example of how we actually collect identities on our website. Joy had this amazing idea to do a hand-drawn pop-up that actually collects their email address. So you've got this lead capture pop-up that comes up that we tested against the previous one, which is this nicely designed one over here that's got nice design aspects, but then we did the hand-drawn one, and it's actually very cool. It looks very nice. So that pops up, we collect their email address first, and then we ask for more information. A second pop-up occurs. Now this got actually a 400% increase in conversion rate. So you can see the increase in conversion rate. It was pretty amazing stuff. It's 4 times as many. Here's another example. We're split testing new ideas all the time. We've got our homepage here. 35% bounce rate. That means people arrived on the page and they popped out. Now, next to it, we tested this page here against it and decreased the bounce rate to 27%. We then did further testing. We're split testing, testing these things against each other. We tested this new page that had a 27% bounce rate against another page with a 20, and we got a 21% bounce rate. So again, we got a decrease in the people that were bouncing out or leaving the website. Now, we tested that page at a 21% bounce rate of people that are popping out of the website, and we brought it down to only 12.8% were actually leaving after a very short period of time. So we had more people sticking around, checking out the site, staying, and we tested pages against each other to develop a page, our homepage, that gets people to stick around. Now, the other thing I want to talk to you about is follow-up. This is one of your jobs as a marketer, and really you need to make sure you do it at the right order of magnitude. Now realize that 80% of your sales are made on the 5th to 12th contact. 80% of your sales. Now, you know, rarely is it like a sale made within the first contact, but you get a much better chance if you contact the people immediately, within the first 5 minutes, if you actually contact those people, get them on the phone, you've got a much higher chance. You can see the difference. You know, it's huge, the amount of times the improvement over actually reaching the person. And the longer you wait, the more likely it is that you're not going to be able to reach them. So, and there's many different ways to do this follow-up. We send out a postcard, we've got a web form that they arrive at, we send out another postcard, an email that's sent to them, they receive a brochure, they're handed one, another phone call. Eventually a person becomes hotter and hotter through this follow-up that occurs all these different ways, and they eventually become your customer, which is the goal. So again, I want to tell you about this book. We've got this book, Don't Make Me Think, A Common Sense Approach to Web Usability by Steve Krug. It's actually a lot of fun to read, very easy to read book. I highly recommend it. And then if you want to get a little bit deeper and a little bit more technical, you can get into this book, Web Design for ROI, which is, you know, gets into exactly how to make sure you actually are converting those browsers into buyers and those prospects into leads. So you might ask, now what? So we've gone through and you've told me about my website, what I need to do with it, but what do I do from here? And the answer is we need to get, you know, some people generated to the driven to this website. Direct mail marketing actually yields an average of 13-to-1 return on investment. So that's quite a statement. You know, that's the average across many industries, across many examples, 13-to-1 return on investment. It actually has 9 times over pay-per-click and email, the response rate of direct mail, 9 times. 60% of consumers have visited a promoted website because of direct mail that they actually received. And finally, 75% of consumers try a business for the first time because of direct mail advertising. So these are the facts of direct mail and how and why it works. So, and we want to use direct mail to drive people to your website so that they can be converted and turned into a lead. And we can not only help you with the postcards, we should start those now, but we can actually help you with your website itself. Here's a little special offer we've got to you. You can reach major league marketing status. We'll give you actually 25% off of any order of 5,000 cards or more. This offer expires in 14 days, but if you call our phone number now, you can save on your marketing for 2017, your tax marketing. So I want you to give us a ring. Call that number right now. We'll put you in with a sales consultant. Tell them you're on the webinar and that you want to go ahead and get rolling here and get your postcard campaign started and rolling out the door. So also, I can send you a free copy of this presentation. Just ask me for it. You know, send me an email, BarryC@postcardmania.com. I would love to hear from you. So just jot that down, send it to me. Yeah, I'm looking forward to sending you that presentation and hearing from you. And then we've got our next event that we're doing. It's March 2nd and 3rd, 2017, our Small Business Owners Growth Summit. It's going to happen right here at Postcard Mania. You can visit postcardmania.com/growth summit. You can find out all about that event and sign up right there. Now, does anybody have any questions? Any questions that they want to get answered before, you know, as we're wrapping up here today? Anybody at all? Well, great. Anybody want to have anything they want to ask? Okay, great. Well, if you're shy and you didn't have any particular questions, no problem. If you think of something after the webinar, you can totally shoot me an email. I would love to pass on some knowledge and give you, you know, some answers to your questions about marketing. So hopefully, you know, this has affected you. You've understand how you could fix your website, improve your website. The website's a constant evolution, so you should be working on it. Why you get your postcards out, work on it this year, probably work on it next year too. You know, if you think about it, you're actually going to be tweaking and improving your website as you go throughout the course of your business, as you saw with what we do with our website. This will actually get you results. So we want to get you started, though, and let's get some traffic to that website. Give us a call, and let's talk about how this affects your business, and let's get you online with a marketing consultant and get rolling here. So, great. I'm Barry Kazire. I want to thank you for joining me today. I appreciate you being here, and I'll look to see you again at our next webinar.